This is a 2018 Honda Odyssey Elite, the top-end model in the Honda Odyssey minivan lineup, and it costs $50,000. That's right, you can now spend $50,000 for a minivan. Today, I'm going to take you on a tour of this thing and show you what you get when you spend 50 grand on a family van. Now, before I get started, I should say that this thing isn't exactly $50,000. I think the window sticker price is something like just a little over $48,000 with shipping, but of course, by the time you've paid taxes and fees, you're leaving the dealership over $50,000. I mention this because it seems like every brand that makes a minivan is scared of crossing the $50,000 barrier. If you go on the Chrysler Pacifica online configurator, you can option one up to like $49,200. The Sienna, like $49,400. This thing, just a little over 48. It's like every brand knows the $50,000 minivan is coming, but they don't want to be the one that makes the $50,000 minivan, so every automaker is just waiting for another one to blink first. But basically, this is a $50,000 minivan. Now, if you're like me and you grew up around cheap, crappy minivans, you might be wondering how this happened. Well, basically, here's what happened. People started using minivans more and more, and then they wanted more features, so they got leather, and then they wanted more features, so they got rear seat VCRs and DVD players, and then things just kept snowballing, and now here we are, the $50,000 minivan. So today I've borrowed this brand new 2018 Odyssey Elite from a viewer here in Orange County, California, and I'm gonna take you on a tour of it. I'm gonna show you all of the interesting quirks and cool features you get when you spend 50 grand on a family van. Then I'm gonna drive it, and then I'll give it a Doug score. And for more of my thoughts on the Odyssey Elite, click the link below to visit autotrader.com/oversteer, where I've also compiled a list of the older, more unusual, low mileage, weird minivans currently listed for sale on AutoTrader. Now, I'm going to start on the outside of the Odyssey Elite with the key. Now, the key looks like every other normal car electronic key, except this one is rather complicated. It has 7 total buttons on it. There's lock, unlock, the door on the left side, the door on the right side, the tailgate, there's the remote starter, and then there's the button for the alarm. It's one of the more bizarrely complicated keys I've seen, and that sort of foreshadows what's coming. Now, I'll move on to the interior of the Odyssey Elite in a minute. I'm going to start on the outside. There's not really that many interesting things on the outside of this car. One of the interesting things is the fact that it has LED headlights, not just LED running lights, but actual LED headlights, like the most modern BMW and Audi and Mercedes-Benz luxury cars, even though this thing is just a Honda minivan. Next up, moving on to the wheels, and how about this? This thing has 19-inch wheels. That's really insane on a minivan. In today's world, many performance cars don't even have 19-inch wheels. Next up, we move on to basically the only other interesting exterior item on the Odyssey, and that is basically all the stuff that's going on back here. The first thing you'll notice on the rear sliding doors is that little kink that I guess is designed to sort of make the car look a little bit more interesting. Also designed to make the car more interesting is the fact that this rear window sort of wraps around all the way to the back. Now, Honda would say that they did this to make the roof look like it's floating and that they want it to look cool and special and not like a boring old minivan, but I have a different theory. I think they prefer to split up the roof panel and the side panel so that they don't have one giant piece they have to put on the side of the car for manufacturing purposes. Nonetheless, it does give the Odyssey sort of a distinctive little look compared to most of its rivals. Next up, I'm going to climb inside the Odyssey. Now, when you do that, you will find a few buttons to the left of the steering wheel. Now, the Odyssey has most of the modern safety tech you'd expect, so I'm going to go through this quickly. You get your lane keep assist, lane departure warning, your parking sensors, your forward collision warning, traction control, and that's your power tailgate as well. Now, the other buttons over to the left of the steering wheel are a little bit more interesting. Those would be your power sliding door button. Now, power sliding doors are not particularly unusual in minivans anymore. Most of them have them now, but the interesting thing about the Odyssey is just how many ways you have to open the power sliding doors. For instance, you can push the little button to the left of the steering wheel and the doors will open. You can tug on the door handle on the outside of the doors, pull it once, and the doors will open. Inside the car, you can tug on the little interior door handle, and the doors will open, or you can press a little open button directly next to the handle and they will open also. So when you're inside, there are two door opening solutions within about 6 inches of each other. And you also have another option, and that would be the key fob. Press and hold the little power door opener buttons on the key fob, and the doors slide right open so that you can just climb right into your Odyssey and back out again. By the way, it's worth noting that all that stuff can also be used to close the doors, including the button on the key fob. Just push it and the door automatically whirs closed, so you don't have to do any work on your own. Next up, a couple of other interesting features inside the Odyssey. Now, when you get into the front seat, you'll notice that the start-stop button sort of lights up in a pale red. Put your foot on the brake pedal and it lights up in a brighter red, as if to signal that it's ready to go. Take your foot off and it's pale red again. Put it back on and it's bright red. Off, pale. On, bright. That's actually the kind of touch that I would expect from a sports car, not from a minivan. Now, when you finally do go and start the car, one of the things you'll notice is that the gauge cluster screen also gives you a touch I'd expect from a sports car. It has this surprisingly sporty startup graphic that's actually rather involved, and when it's finally displaying the regular gauge cluster, it lights up in this nice unbroken line of blue that also loops in the engine temperature and the fuel gauge, which I kind of like. Now, there's nothing especially interesting in the gauge cluster, but I will say one of the options in this vehicle, if you want, you can turn off the readout for the tachometer. You don't even have to look at it if you don't want to, which I think kind of illustrates the type of person who's buying this vehicle. You can just turn off the tach and you don't even have to pay attention to what your engine is doing. Now, next up, speaking of screens, we move on to the center infotainment system, which houses quite a few interesting quirks, one of which is just endless configurability. I don't recall ever seeing any car, even a luxury car, with this many configurable things. For example, the Odyssey lets you choose which time zone you're in. That is not all that unusual. A little bit more unusual is the fact that you don't choose like Pacific or Central European. Instead, you choose based on the city that you're in. Now, that wouldn't be that weird, except for the cities that they give you. It's quite a wide array. Here, for instance, is Nuuk in Greenland, which is on West Greenland Standard Time. Now, Nuuk is a city of like 5,000 people with no stoplights. I'm going to tell you right now, Honda engineers, nobody's going to be driving one of these up in Nuuk. Now, the interesting thing is the cities aren't displayed alphabetically. Instead, they're displayed in some other order. Nuuk comes before London. I think it's actually displayed based on proximity to you. Nonetheless, it is kind of unusual. Now, there are a couple of other interesting configurable items in the infotainment system as well. For example, touch sensitivity. Most car infotainment systems, there's just one level. You touch stuff and it does what you want, and sometimes it's too sensitive and sometimes it isn't. In this car, you can choose, and it even recommends that you put it on high sensitivity if you're wearing gloves, because then it's more likely to pick up your touches. Now, beyond that, some of the other configurability options in this car are just crazy. For example, you can configure the automatic headlight sensitivity. Now, that's not all that surprising. You have it turn on when it's just getting dark or when it's fully dark, whatever. But I figured it'd be like high and low. Instead, it gives you 5 different options for your automatic headlight's light sensitivity. And here's the crazy thing. You have 5 more options for your interior light's nighttime light sensitivity. So you can have your headlights turn on the moment it starts to get dark and your interior ambient lights not turn on until it's fully dark. Or you can change from any one of the 5 settings on the way there. Now, beyond the configurability, one of the things I like about the infotainment system is that if you go into settings in your vehicle settings to see your maintenance information, you have the option of choosing between A, engine oil, or 1, tire rotation. Not A and B, or 1 and 2, but A and 1. It's a good thing there's not a third option in here, or else they would probably have to start resorting to the Greek alphabet. Also, something else I like about the infotainment system, if you get tired of the endless configurability and the navigation system and the climate controls, you can just have it display a clock. The thing I like about the clocks is that the clock options are just kind of ridiculous. There are some really crazy ones. Now, I personally like this one with the insects because when you select it, it just says the day of the month. It doesn't say January 20, February 20, it just says 20. You can figure out the rest. Also interesting, this infotainment system lets you configure the interruption priority. So you're driving along, you get a call from someone you don't care about, it won't interrupt you as you're belting out Jimmy Eat World on the radio. But you're driving along and you get a call from someone who you want to, a contact that you've starred, and it will interrupt you. That's kind of a cool feature, but take a closer look at that interruption screen. It doesn't just say set priority of interruptions, it says set priority interruptions of from who? That doesn't make sense, Honda. That just doesn't make sense. I don't know what to tell you. Next up in the infotainment system, we move on to two of the coolest features in any car on the road today. Car, truck, minivan, luxury car, doesn't matter. I will start with cabin watch. Now, you're driving along in a normal minivan and your kids are making a ruckus in the back seat. So you turn around and yell at them and you're not paying attention to the road and you run off the road and it's just not a good situation. That won't happen in the Odyssey Elite. That's because it has cabin watch. There is a camera in the back seat that lets you monitor your children from the infotainment screen. And check this out. Not only can you look back in the back seats, but you can move the camera around to choose where you want to look most. So if your kids are making a ruckus in the second row, zoom in on the second row. If it's a problem in the third row, you can zoom over there. That's crazy, but it isn't the craziest. The craziest would be cabin talk. Cabin talk is the coolest thing I've seen. Basically, you're driving along and you want to tell your kids something back there. You want to yell at them to be quiet or whatever. You don't have to turn around and yell. You push cabin talk and a microphone comes on. You speak and it is projected into the back. Take a listen to how this works.
All right, now here's how this works. My camera microphones are off. You are positioned right now where a third row passenger would be. And here is me talking normally, and here is me talking normally as if I faced forward. Now, let me go over and get cabin talk on. Now listen to me. Hello, Odyssey passengers. Visit autotrader.com/oversteer. Doug is the type of guy who talks into an Odyssey microphone. All right, now listen to this. Hello, Odyssey passengers. Now, I'm gonna turn off the mic. I'm gonna whisper. Hello, Odyssey passengers. Mic back on. Hello, Odyssey passengers. Off. Hello, Odyssey passengers. My name is Doug. My name is Doug. Tell me that isn't one of the coolest tricks you've seen in any new car.
Next up, moving on to a few other things inside the front of the Odyssey beyond the infotainment system. One of the things I like is the climate controls. Instead of integrating the climate controls into the infotainment system so you have to go in there and find your climate app every time you want to change something, they're actual real buttons. You just push them and it has a little display screen. It's easy to use, simple, just like every climate control you've ever used. I like that. I also like the fact that the cooled seat buttons and the heated seat buttons have their own buttons, so you just climb in, you push them, you don't have to go into the infotainment screen. Another interesting thing in this car, the eco mode button. You push it and then a little leaf appears in the gauge cluster. However, that leaf has nothing on snow mode. Push the snow mode button and a little diagram of the Odyssey comes up in the gauge cluster driving in a snowstorm. Push it again, it's on a nice dry day. Push it again, snowstorm. Again, dry and clear. If I were driving an Odyssey, I think I would just press that button all the time because I would be so mesmerized by it. Also interesting is the Odyssey's gear selector. This thing doesn't have a traditional gear lever and it doesn't have a column shifter or a little rotary dial. Instead, you get four basically buttons in the center control stick. There's one for park. For reverse, it's a little lever you push down. Then there's neutral and below that is drive, and little lights light up on the outside of them to kind of let you know that you're in each gear. It's really unusual, but this is what Honda is going to in all of their vehicles. It's one of the stranger gear selectors in the entire car industry. Next up, we move on to the second row of seats, which is where more of the Odyssey Elite magic happens. Now, when you take a quick look back here, you'll notice that it just doesn't look all that nice. The materials aren't that good. There's crappy plastic everywhere. It's not what you'd expect from a $50,000 car. But here's the thing. When you pay 50 grand for a minivan, you don't want nice materials. You want really practical. And this is that. Here's what I mean. Right now in this configuration, this car seats 8. 2 in the front, 3 here, and 3 back there. But let's say I don't want this here. Instead, I want an armrest. Well, I pull this little loop, and then this thing is down, and I got an armrest. I also have 3 additional cup holders and a little storage cubby. But what if I want captain's chairs back here? I want this thing completely gone. I don't even want to look at it. Here's what you do. Just reach in here, pull a little tab here, pull back here, and then this thing is gone, oh, completely. It's a little heavy, but it's easy to remove. And now suddenly you have captain's chairs in the second row. It's the easiest seat I've ever seen to take out of a car, especially consider I didn't have to remove either of the seats on the other side to get the middle seat out. But removing the middle seat is nothing compared to what comes next. This next item is one of my favorite Odyssey features. Picture this, you've loaded your kids in their car seats in the configuration like this, but suddenly one of their friends wants to come along. Well, it would be annoying to remove the car seat, pull the seat forward so the friend can get in the third row, and so instead, pull this, and the seat slides that way so that you can easily access the third row. Then you put your kids together back here and they start fighting, because of course they do. So you want to separate them. Instead of sending one to the back, maybe the back is already full, pull it again, and now your kids are separated. Now, of course, you've heard of seats that slide forward and backward, and these also do that, just like seats in most normal cars. But forward and backward is so last a decade when you can slide the seats side to side. And here's the really crazy thing about this. You don't have to just have it all the way in the side or completely in the middle. If for some reason you want your seat like halfway, you can do it. A little more, you can do it. So there's basically an endless amount of configurations. If you have certain items that are a certain size, you need the seat moved over just a little, you can do it. But let's say you gotta put someone in the third row, you can't or don't wanna take out the middle seat, you're wondering how hard is it to get in the back of this thing, and so unfortunately, I will now demonstrate it. You pull this little latch, the seat slides forward, and then you climb in back. If you're 6'4", as I am, it's a little bit challenging. If you're a kid, it actually isn't all that bad, and it's just one motion with this thing. You just pull this little latch, it slides forward, and then you're good to go. You want the seat back? It's back, and I have enough room here that I could live, although I'd personally prefer not to be back here. But the people who watch my videos are primarily into luxury cars and sports cars, and they're gonna say, yeah, but still, it's ugly back there, and it doesn't really look that nice. Well, here's the thing. When you're buying a minivan, you know your kids are gonna come back here and put Doritos between the seats and draw on everything with crayon. You don't want nice, you want practical. So you want those seat things, and also, here are some other things that are back here. There are, in the second row alone, 4 armrests, 7 cup holders, 3 in the middle, 2 in front, and 1 on each door. There are 2 USB ports, there's 1 HDMI port, there's a screen that drops down from the ceiling with its own remote control, and there are even 2 rear sunshades for each window on the sliding doors themselves, so that you don't have to get one of those little stick-on sunshades. They're already built into this car, and you can just use the ones that it comes with. If you're a backseat passenger in this thing, you also have your own complete set of climate controls. So when your kids back here complain to the people in front that they want the air a different temperature, well, they can go ahead and do that. Also cool about this car, something I noticed, it has a rear seat DVD player, but it also has a sunroof that opens fully. They were able to get both of those things to work together in this car that hasn't been available in some past Odyssey models and some other vehicles with a rear DVD player. Next up, I'm moving on to the third row. Now keep in mind, I'm in the third row, the furthest row of seats in this vehicle, the ones that are least likely to be used, and yet the practicality march continues. There are still 2 more climate control vents back here, 2 headphone jacks, there's a cigarette lighter outlet, there are 4 more cup holders back here, bringing the total number of cup holders in this van to 15. That's a lot of drinks for up to 8 people. And additionally, there are little sunshades for the rear windows contoured to fit the shape of the unusual Odyssey rear windows. And that's the third row. Now, I've covered the interior, I've covered the exterior. You probably think we're done, but we must first move on to the cargo area where the Odyssey is hiding some of its most interesting tricks. I'm gonna start with the magic seat. Now, here's the deal. Car companies have been making seats easier and easier to fold down so that you can just put them down easily and put stuff in the back. But none are quite as easy as this one. Take a look at this. You wanna fold the seat down? And the seat is down. You can't even measure that in seconds. It's that simple. You want to put it back up, and it is back up. It really is a magic seat, and it's very impressive. I also like the fact that the little dangly loop you use to put the seat down has a little tiny Velcro piece on the back of the seat so that you can just stick it right in and it won't dangle around and get in the way of your cargo if you have the seat in place. And then, of course, we must move on to one of the Odyssey Elite's coolest party tricks, and that would be the fact that it has a built-in vacuum cleaner. It's called Honda Vac, and it's back here, and they put it in here so when your kids spill crumbs and crap all over your car, you don't have to go get your household vacuum cleaner. Instead, you just unfurl this giant snake-looking thing and then press this little button on the side and then... Oh. Look, now I'm vacuuming! Now, the interesting thing about the Honda Vac is it isn't just a vacuum cleaner, it even has attachments so that you can use it specific parts of the car for specific purposes. Now, when your Honda Vac gets too full of kids' crumbs and their other crap, you can actually empty it, and it's pretty simple. That is in this little compartment down here. You push it and then press to release the compartment, and then the entire thing comes out, and then you just take it wherever you want, empty it, and you're good to go. And that is the built-in Honda Odyssey vacuum cleaner. So that's a comprehensive tour of everything you get when you spend $50,000 on a minivan. And if you're a parent, you have to admit, put aside the minivan egg-shaped styling and the uncool image, and be honest, you kind of want that stuff. Anyway, now it's time to take it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, time to drive the Odyssey. Now, if you haven't watched this video all the way through this point, I think you're crazy because this car is full of weird crap. If you're starting to watch now, I wouldn't blame you for turning off. Because this thing, I don't want to spoil the surprise, but this thing drives like a minivan. I'm gonna floor it. Okay, well, first off, that's quicker than it has any business being. But nonetheless, it's not fast. I don't really actually know what the horsepower rating is, and neither does anyone who owns one of these, so it works out. All right, here's a hard corner. Oh, that's some lean. that is some body lean. I don't think there's much effort paid to trying to make this thing sporty. And I mean, just to be clear, I'm kind of joking about this as I'm driving it, but I don't fault it for that. I think you gotta kind of be an idiot if you're one of these people who's like, oh, I want a sporty minivan. Well, that's not... They're incongruous. I mean, if you want a vehicle this size with this level of stuff, and you're not going to get that from a minivan. It's just not going to happen with, you know, performance. It's a big seating area from the floor all the way to the roof. I mean, I've got inches above me. The seat could go lower, and I'm pretty tall, obviously. And also, you're just not in an SUV. It's just you're just acutely aware of that. You're not that high up. The windshield slopes way down, so it looks like one of those old Dustbuster GM vans. You kind of know you're not in something cool when you drive one of these. It's really well thought out and excellent. It's kind of interesting. It's interesting to drive this for me as someone who usually is in luxury cars and sports cars where ergonomics are not necessarily at the very forefront, and there's some weird stuff that automakers do for styling purposes or whatever. This thing, there's no compromises. It's designed for your convenience to make things as easy as possible, and that shows. And so that's the 2018 Honda Odyssey Elite. Elite is a good trim level name for this van because it is available only to the customers who want the very most from their van and the elites who are willing to pay for it. I still don't understand why they don't make a true luxury minivan. Not the Mercedes R-Class that they couldn't bring themselves to call a minivan that had regular opening rear doors, but I mean a Lexus or Acura minivan with regular rear sliding doors. I think people would buy it, and I think this thing is proof. But until that day comes, this is the closest thing we have to a luxury minivan. And now it's time to give it a Doug score. Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Odyssey is an attractive minivan, but it's still a minivan. Still, the fact that it isn't heinously ugly means it gets an average score of 5 out of 10. Next up is acceleration. The Odyssey does 0 to 60 in 7.4 seconds, giving it a 1 out of 10. Handling is really mediocre, but not dangerous, which is enough to earn it a 3 out of 10. Cool factor is, of course, really low, but I simply cannot assign a 1 to a vehicle that has an in-car microphone, a zoomable camera to monitor rear passengers, and a vacuum cleaner. It gets a 2 out of 10. Finally, there's importance. This van will move on to the second owner, a young family, and then the third owner, a flower shop. Then it'll be used as a taxi until it gets to 312,000 miles, at which point it'll end up in a junkyard where someone will steal the vacuum cleaner. This is a car to be used, not preserved, and it gets a 1 out of 10, bringing the total weekend score to 12 out of 50, ahead of only the Mitsubishi Mirage and the Nissan Murano Cross Cabriolet, which seems right. Next, we move on to the daily categories, starting with features. The
Odyssey doesn't have the usual complement of self-driving tech I require to give cars a really high score, but it has so much other insane stuff, I have to give it an 8 out of 10. Comfort is decent, but not luxury car great, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Quality is fine, the Odyssey is reliable enough, but the interior materials are only average, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Practicality is obvious, the Odyssey gets a 10 out of 10 and probably deserves our first ever 11. Finally, there's value. I know this thing is expensive, but it's also just packed to the brim with conveniences and brilliant inventions, and I simply have to give it an 8 out of 10, bringing the total daily score to 40 out of 50. That's 1 point off the all-time high, which was the Lincoln Navigator, and it illustrates what a great car the Navigator really is, since the Odyssey is such a good daily car. Add it all up, and the total Doug score is 52 out of 100. Simply put, the Odyssey Elite is probably the greatest minivan of all time. Until the next Sienna comes out, then that'll be the greatest minivan of all time, until the next Kia Sedona, and then the next Pacifica, and it just rotates. But for now, this is the one to have.
Ooh. Oh, now this is just fun.